talking to you about three things today. Firstly, the role of the classroom. Secondly, how streaming disrupts this role. And lastly, how it affects our culture in general, with specific respect to the family. Before that, let's cover a few rebuttals. Now, we generally, firstly, accept the idea that you can test academic ability, and that yes, at some certain point in time, students should be assessed in order to make them go to university or get jobs and whatnot. We accept that fact and that you can do that. What you cannot test, however, is the potential of a student, especially at a certain point in time. It can't be tested, and neither should it be used to segregate individuals when they are nowhere near the point in time whereby they are realizing and exercising their said capabilities and full potential. Because as my second speaker has already mentioned in his POI, if you chronologically disrupt the development of said individual or child, it essentially means that in the future he's going to have a far harder time catching up. And that's what we are concerned with, the lowest common denominators of society, not necessarily the smart ones. The second thing that we have to note in terms of assessments is that these things are not necessarily objective either. Every time you administer a test, it gives you a certain number of criteria. It is a certain number of particular things that you are testing for. There is no one test or one exam that can say that you are amazing and generally great as a human being in these particular sense. Other than saying, yes, you have this particular set of knowledge and expertise and capabilities, and that's what you can assess, rather than the fact that you are therefore special and should receive special treatment at the end of the day. The second point that we have to contend then is the idea that you can actually teach clever, that you can't teach clever ones and dumb people in the same, here's the point anyway. It's unnecessary to segregate them into different classrooms because firstly you realize that teachers, at least competent ones, middle ground ones across the board in general, should be able to challenge their smarter students within the classroom and at the same time give additional support or even additional lessons to the slower ones outside the classroom, or even pay more attention to them during class time. Therefore, we don't see why there's a need to segregate them into different classrooms in the first place. But secondly, we tell you that there is a great harm when you do this. Because firstly, when you talk about motivation, you realize then that anyone who is given the dumb label put into the slower class and thereby inevitably given the lousier teachers because of the fact that they are hopeless cases essentially means that these people are never going to have the chance to fully realize their potential. It means that they are subject to a hell whereby they have an even higher mountain to climb than they would have had if they were left alone in a normal middle classroom where everyone is generally allowed to mix. Therefore, we contend that this is a good thing, and in fact say that there is a great harm in this particular case. Given a label, it's called the Pygmalion effect. It's a tested theory in the papers, whereby essentially put, students labeled smart perform better, and students labeled dumb perform worse. Before we move on to positive matter, anyone?
Yes. Please. So you're perfectly fine with somebody, say, climbing a high mountain and give up in the middle of the way, than say, climbing small hills and build up sort of confidence and then, you know, realize his
full potential. Here's the thing. At the end of the day, all these people are going to be subject to the same tests and assessments, meaning that they have the same hill to climb, essentially. But here's the thing at the end of the day. Here's the essential thing. When you put a slower person into a classroom full of other slower individuals, it doesn't matter what sort of rubrics they use to assess them. They are going to be set aside from the rest of the entire school and mocked for being slower and dumber and whatnot. And as Albert Einstein has proven, geniuses can be extremely late bloomers. In any case, let's move on to the role of the classroom. Now, the education system exists to develop people in a holistic manner. It tries to maximize their potential so that they can do their best in future in society as an adult. How is this harmed in this particular scenario? The first thing that we have to know is that the classroom environment via competition becomes a zero-sum game. It means that there is a pecking order literally that involves, that determines how you're going to be educated, who's going to be educating you, how many resources are going to be put into you, because of the very simple fact that people will always believe that the better ones deserve more and the lousier ones don't. But, and even if you put an official policy in place against this, we still understand that social perception in that microcosm within the school itself, between peers who refuse to help each other or who choose to mock these slower students, essentially then means that there is a huge stigma that's attached to this and that drags them down with regard to their motivations and desire to find that purpose and actually get educated in a proper manner. In any case, the second thing that we have to note then in terms of learning and development is that smart students themselves need this exposure to individuals who are slower. They need exposure not just to individuals who are slower, but individuals from racial minorities and from poorer parts of society. Now, how does that link together? Here's the thing. Very often, we have to say that academic performance, especially from a young age, is determined very greatly by your socioeconomic circumstances. The very fact that your parents can afford to feed you better, that you don't have to walk to school every day, the fact that you can afford tuition teachers, essentially means that certain parts of society have an advantage in the academic playing field. Because at the end of the day, then, if you start streaming from a small age, before anyone from a lousier socioeconomic background or ethnicity has the time to catch up and match all these other normal people, so-called, it essentially means there's a stratification within the classroom that results in ethnic minorities and poorer people being disproportionately disadvantaged in this classroom, and thereby cementing and crystallizing this very poor cycle of poverty that they are already enduring. And other than that very fact that you are entrenching these inequalities, the very essential thing remains that school is a microcosm of society that's supposed to prepare you for the eventuality. Smart kids and slow kids are going to have to learn to work together anyway in the future. And we think that you should be starting as early as possible in order that they allow learning to happen horizontally, because learning does not just occur in a vertical sense, top down from teacher to student. We think that they should collaborate rather than compete. And as a student of Singapore, I am very proud to